society believes that when women are confident in their work, that we are arrogant or we're bitches. And I've been perceived as maybe a bit pretentious sometimes or arrogant, but I'm not.
Gaga.
Hi.
Thanks so much for coming out.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
How are you?
You are on the record with Fuse.
Yes.
Tell me about your creative process, how you come up with the song. And I love this idea that you said it's your job to have mind-blowing, irresponsible, condomless sex with whatever idea you're writing about. I mean, that's what an artist should strive to do.
It is, but in real life, you should always have sex with a condom.
Of course, of course. We're talking about hypothetical, figurative.
It was a hypothetical, metaphorical comment about how I like to roll around and wrestle with my music. And it comes from a very deep place.
But how do you come up with your songs? Is it pen to paper? Are you sitting at the piano?
It's whenever. Whenever it comes.
Whatever the muse.
Praise God, whenever it comes. Because creativity for me is like, it's religious. Sometimes with the piano, and sometimes I just hear something and I write it out loud, and sometimes I'm just humming, or I'm in the studio and I'm making a beat and I'm singing along. It's always different. When I wrote Monster, I had this vision. I had this vision of the way that I have seen men for so long, monsters.
Bad monsters or good monsters or both?
Well, I like monsters, but monsters are bad for you, I guess. So that's what the record was about.
Why do you want to be famous?
Well, fame for me is not external, it's internal. So right. I've been famous for a long time. And I certainly know that my destiny is to be a storyteller in the world and a liberator in the world. So I guess you could say my external fame is a voice.
Do you know what Strong J means?
Strong J?
Yeah, I'm talking about like Grace Jones.
Okay, yeah. Well,
Strong J.
Yeah.
I mean, that's you. That's so much of who you are.
Grace is a huge inspiration to me. The androgyny of the woman is this kind of fascinating thing that nobody understands or wants to understand unless you're in the beautiful subculture that is my fans and also the gay community. They get it instantly.
Yeah.
And they love it.
When Madonna says, you have that it factor, what does that do to you? I mean, it sounds like a heap of pressure to me.
That's kind of like saying that Rivera can't handle the ninth inning.
Yankee references from Gaga, I love that.
But you know what I mean?
But
you know,
you're Mariano Rivera.
I'm a closer. But I guess what I'm trying to say is, when Madonna says something like that, I'm not the kind of woman that that pisses out in the ninth inning. I rise and I close.
I mean, you're a cultural phenomenon now. I mean, like, there were tons of Gagas for Halloween. Cartman on South Park is singing Poker Face. I mean, you know, how does it feel when you're like, you know, you've exploded beyond the music business to just everybody talking about you and thinking about you?
Well, that's the idea. I want to be a part of culture. When I say I'm an artist of liberation, that is where the work is. It's in culture, it's in society, it's with the people. I don't care about what people think of me. I care what they think of themselves. When they come to my shows, my fans aren't sitting there going, oh my God, I love Gaga. They're going, I feel so cool right now that I'm here.
I love that you love Andy Warhol. Yeah. Talk about what you love about him and how he influences you.
One of my favorite things he said is, artists make things that people don't need. And I was in Paris and I saw this painting and it looked nothing like a Warhol. And I started to cry. I was just staring at this painting thinking, why don't you look like a Warhol? And he made it when he was, you know, like 23, when he was my age. And I said, I feel like that painting. I feel like I have not yet defined my aesthetic. So I'm just beginning. Now I'm in my silkscreen period.
Do you cry a lot?
Lately I cry quite a bit, yeah. To be perfectly honest. But I cry a lot when I write.
Were you popular in high school?
No.
No?
No.
Were you tormented in high school?
Yeah. Oh. Oh, you used the wrong word. You know, I had friends, of course.
Yeah.
I think everyone has at least one friend.
But?
But I was not really understood. I felt out of place. I felt like a misfit.
Hmm.
And but then when I left school, I loved that I was a misfit. And I met all kinds of people. I realized I had a whole group of new friends that I could raise my freak flag with.
Well, yeah, tell me about the becoming, well, taking the name Lady Gaga.
It started out kind of as a sweet, loving joke, and then it became something my friends all called me, and then I used it as a burlesque name. So, you know, I just sort of became known as Gaga.
Well, what was the point in your mind and the process in your mind when you said, okay, Lady Gaga is my name and I will respond to nothing else from here
forward? No, I respond to Stephanie, but my mom calls me Gaga now.
Your mom calls you Gaga.
Yeah, but it's because, you know, it's like a nickname. Like, you know, like if your dad calls you Skip.
But at what point do you fully become Gaga? I mean, I know it's always in you, but at a certain point, it subsumes you and it becomes all of you rather than being a part of you.
It happened around 5 years ago, but it's sort of like a mantra. It's kind of, you know, you repeat it to yourself every day. Music is my life. Music is my life. The fame is inside of me. I'm going to make a number one record and with number one hits, and it's not yet. It's a lie. You're saying a lie over and over and over again, and then one day, the lie is true.
Do you find your songs funny? Because Just Dance in particular is hysterical.
Well, I think that on the Fame, there was a lot of humor, and there's more humor even in the Fame Monster, but it's a bit more kind of morbid.
How long is psycho? Your vertigo stick. While you in Mara window, baby is sick.
I want your psycho, your vertigo stick. Want you in my rear window, baby, you're sick. I'm listing Hitchcock films and giving them a sexual connotation. But in reality, what I'm saying is I want your horror. You know, I want your fears. Whatever baggage you have, I've got it too, baby. Give it all to me. I want your psycho, I want your ugly, I want all the most disgusting parts of you that you think nobody will ever love. I love all of those things.
Ra, ra, ah, ah, Roma, Roma, ma, ga, ga, ooh, la, la, wild, you're the romance.
I love Bad Romance.
Thank you.
And it's exciting because it's a sort of different direction for you. It's a bigger song. It's just so large. You know, I want to hear it in like a gigantic club.
Well, I spent a lot of time in Eastern Europe, in Russia and in Germany, and I really fell in love with industrial gothic music. It's very, very niche oriented. So I thought, what if I did sort of a pop experimentation with, you know, super pop melodies, and I wanted it to be halfway in between my previous work and a departure, something new and bigger.
I want your ugly, I want your disease. I want your everything as long as it's free.
I want your ugly, I want your disease. Like, I'm like, what, you know, the love is just all encompassing. Whatever you got, I want it.
I want your ugly, I want your disease, all of those things that I'm saying. It's like when you love someone so much and your fear of losing someone is so deep that I want your psycho, I want your ugly, I want all the most disgusting parts of you that you think nobody will ever love. I love all of those things. Each song represents a different monster that I feel like I've encountered on the road. So my fear of love, my fear of alcohol, my fear of sex.
Well, I want to talk about those specifically because there's a lot of fear of monsters within this. But okay, so for you, fear of sex, what does that mean?
Well, Alejandro, which is one of the songs on the album, that's my fear of sex monster. And in that song, I'm saying goodbye to all my past lovers. It's symbolic of me moving on.
What about fear of alcohol?
Well, fear of alcohol is sort of in a mixture of two songs. One in So Happy I Could Die, and that song is happy in the club with a bottle of red wine, stars in our eyes because we're having a good time. Yeha, so happy I could die. It's a fear of that happy place that we get to when we're in an addictive state.
I would expect you to have a fear of fame monster in there somewhere. Is there no fear of fame and what it does to a person and how it changes your life?
You know, it's very funny because I didn't intend on writing a new album, and that's really what this is.
It's
a re-release that is my old record attached to an entirely new album.
Right.
And when I woke up and it was all done, I hadn't written about fame, and I didn't write about money, and I didn't write about celebrities or paparazzi. I wrote about everything else.
We're gonna talk about this, but it's not really a new album because you have the old songs and 8 new ones, right?
Well, I guess for me it is. It's just in conjunction with the first album, it makes it much more of a complete sense.
When you come up with 8 songs, why not do 4 or 5 or 6 more and do a proper album rather than giving us the fame added on with 8 new songs?
Well, it would only be maybe 4 more records, right, to sort of meet the industry standard of what most artists put out as a record. But the album in itself, The Fame Monster, is the yang to the ying of the fame. It's finished.
In the Book of Gaga, which comes with the album, right, you are selling locks of your hair. How much hair do you have to sell?
Well, it's not my real hair.
So it's parts of wigs that you've bought?
Yeah, well, I've never really been very secretive about wearing wigs. So yeah. I guess I didn't know what to do with all of them, so I said, take them and tear them up and give them to my fans, because my fans would love that.
Yeah.
My little monsters, they love very specific things, and I know what they need.
Why do you call your fans monsters?
I think it's because my show is kind of like an exorcism. We identify with one another. I see myself in my fans, and they see themselves in me. And I call them little monsters because they're my inspiration.
I love Poker Face. Can't quite figure out what are you saying when you say he can't read my poker face.
Well, the song was about fantasizing about women when I was in bed with my ex-boyfriend. So I didn't really want him to know because it bothered him. And that was the inspiration behind the song.
You talk about that you can have sex with women, but you won't love women.
No.
Okay, tell
That's
me.
That's twisting my words.
Tell me.
I have loved all women. I love so many women in my life.
But you're physical, with women.
I've never been in love with a woman in a romantic way.
Okay, so, I mean, that's what I meant. But I just wonder why you haven't been in love with the female heart in that romantic way.
I don't know. But I certainly have beautiful relationships with women that I've been very close with.
Yeah.
I don't know if even I can say I've ever been in love with a man.
Really?
Yeah.
But you consider yourself bi, right?
Yeah, I do.
I mean, and you said that letting that be known, you regret because you said you are, it seems to some that you're using the gay community to seem edgy, which doesn't.
No, that's not true.
Okay, tell me.
I don't think that's true. I think the gay community knows where I stand.
I mean, it does make you seem edgy, but it's not a thing that you're using, it's who you are.
That's why I don't really talk about it very much. Because then it becomes
a thing.
A thing.
Yeah.
That's why I say let's talk about the music. But I am honest about it so that I'm clear. When I hear one of the most famous rappers in the world say something homophobic on the radio, I want people to yell at him.
Gay rights rally in D.C. was a really powerful moment for you, and it was a really important moment for you. Why was it so important?
Because this country's not fully equal.
Right.
The stigmas around the gay community are so wrong, so misinformed, and so incorrect. And I truthfully felt honored to be asked to not only perform, but to speak. the gay community doesn't yet have full equality in America, but we're on our way.
You made a big deal about it at the gay rights rally that you wouldn't stand for the behavior in the music business. Are you talking about things that artists do, or are you talking about things behind the scenes as well?
I'm just talking about everything. I think that some say, you know, or feel about artists that are politically involved or have very strong, you know, religious beliefs, I'll just shut up and sing. But I'm not speaking about something that I don't know about.
Right.
I'm speaking about something that I know so much about. And I feel very strongly about it. And I took a stand and I mean it.
Do you even understand why some people, or it seems so many people, think homosexuality is immoral, think that gay rights are not civil rights and everybody doesn't deserve equal rights and these sort of things?
Well, of course I'm not ignorant to the way that everyone has their own opinions about politics and religion. I feel, even just in the music industry, that there's very public misogynistic and homophobic behavior. When I hear one of the most famous rappers in the world say something homophobic on the radio, I want people to yell at him.
Who are you talking about?
I don't have to say who, because they know who they are.
But there's a lot of homophobia in hip-hop, so are you, like, just disappointed in that within hip-hop?
It's not just hip-hop, it's everywhere.
But hip-hop is strong on its homophobia.
It's wrong. It's very wrong. I'm not trying to create and generate more hatred in the world. For example, I don't want to point anyone out and then all of a sudden all these fans get angry and I hate that person. I just want to generate awareness. It's always wrong to hate, but it's never wrong to love.
I mean, that's very Gandhi, it's very Dr. King, and that's powerful. But, you know, you also need the Malcolm X and the Black Panthers. I mean, gay people are getting beat up in the street and people just watch. So, I mean, at some level, there needs to be that ACT UP, that sort of stronger part of the movement that says, you know what, you're wrong.
Maybe that's your opinion, but I don't believe in any hatred or any warlike behavior. I believe in commitment and love and positivity. So that might be your opinion, but I'll stay with Gandhi.
Okay.
Stay with Gandhi and Martin.
Tell me about some of the button-pushing things you do. I mean, I love the paparazzi video, and I can see where some people are, like, kind of thrown off because you're, you know, in a wheelchair and you're paralyzed through most of the video. And why did you decide to go that route?
Well, I'm excited I pushed your buttons. The song to me is the beginning, and then the video and the live performances and the appearances, those are layers of more expression in which I can grow and change what the song is about endlessly. In that video, I wanted to talk about the death of the celebrity. Mm-hmm. And do we kill them or do they kill themselves? So it was meant to be a pop cultural commentary. There's glamorous women dying all over the house. It was meant to be serious.
And the bleeding at the VMAs, what were you saying there?
I had this vision of monsters, blood, you know, devil, monsters, demons. I thought about Christ. I think I thought in a performance art commentary kind of way, if I show the media what my demise and my death looks like as the artist Lady Gaga, that they'll stop looking for it.
So yeah, an incredible night for all around. You're about to go on tour at that point, the Fame Kills with Kanye, and you're there, and he goes on stage with Taylor Swift and embarrasses himself, and you're about to go on tour with this man. What are you thinking about when you learned about what he did up there?
I sort of thought, oh geez. But honestly, to be totally honest, I wasn't thinking about the tour at all. Kanye's my friend.
Right.
So I was just thinking about him and Taylor and, you know, Beyonce. And that was it. And it was just one of those things. It was kind of this freak moment that happened.
Tell me something that we're going to get from this Monster Ball tour. Because I know you are cooking up ideas, things you've never seen before. I know when it's the Gaga show, you're going to go there.
there's certainly something very magical that happens when the whole House of Gaga can be together. There's a theme of evolution and change. So I begin as a cell and I grow throughout the show. Tremendously innovative choreography, insane fashion installations. We're doing things that I've never been done before. And I'm playing all the music from The Fame and all the music from The Fame Monster. And I've been telling my fans it's a giant post-apocalyptic house party.
Post-apocalyptic house party. I like that.
Like I say, associate the apocalypse with monsters.
So in 10 years, where are you gonna be?
Right here with you, talking about another record.
I hope so. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're awesome.
The 2011 Grammys are just around the corner. Fuse reviews the last year in music with the artists themselves.
The original approach to making music is much more focused and refined.
The Fuse Grammy Preview 2011 premieres Tuesday at 7 p.m. 6 Central.
In November of 2009, after The Fame Monster came out, Lady Gaga met with me for an On the Record to discuss everything. In a lengthy interview, Gaga talked about her music, her sexuality, and her support for gay rights. What you're about to see are the lost tapes from that interview, the unreleased footage, where she discusses her parents, President Obama, her typical day, her struggle not to be a control freak, and the death of Michael Jackson. It's the second part of a rare one-on-one with music's hottest young superstar. This is Lady Gaga on the record with Fuse, The Lost Tapes.
Anyone can be famous, but my music is very soulful. My religion is my music. I'm obsessed with monsters. I've worked hard since I was very young. You don't tell me what I want to hear. Tell me the truth.
Bobby Brown said people get into the music business for two reasons. To show off their talent, like Whitney Houston did, or to be the life of the party, like Bobby did. Which are you?
I'm neither of those things.
So what are you?
I got into the music business to liberate. I want to liberate the world. My art is liberation.
From what?
From whatever it is that's chaining you or imprisoning you or making you feel like a freak sometimes and like you don't fit in. My shows, my music, it's all part of a performance art piece that's designed to liberate. Mainstream America and mainstream music around the world, that was my challenge. But that's why I've never given up. That's why I've insisted I have to bleed to death for 4 minutes. I have to do it this way. My video must say this. It's staying in my space and not trying to react to what's going on around me, but just staying here.
It's tough.
Well, it's tough if the ideas stop, but that's why you have to listen to the voices. My religion is my music, so when it comes, that's something I'm really diligent about is my visions. And I know I might sound like some, you know, overly spiritual artist, but in truth, I would just be nothing without my spirituality. And it's my visions that carry through to my records.
And the bleeding at the VMAs, what were you saying there?
Like I said about visions, I have these visions about what I need to say and what comes next. And I had this vision of Frida Kahlo paintings, and she was bleeding from her heart. Thought about Madame Butterfly. And then I thought about what my obsession was when I was in high school, which was beautiful actresses and models and singers that died.
Like who?
Marilyn Monroe, Judy Garland, Sylvia Plath, JonBenet Ramsey. We never really saw what happened to these women. We just heard about it, because somehow the enigma of their existence was encapsulated. So I wanted to say a few things with this performance. Here it is. Here's the image that you're all wondering about.
I mean, I love that you are a complete artist. You're doing these great performances, and you're giving us great records, and you're giving us all this fashion. You know, it's a full thing.
Well, it's performance art. That's what makes me different. You know, I'm not just a pop singer. I'm not just a writer. I'm a designer. I designed my stage set with the House of Gaga for the Monster Ball. The clothing, you know, it's fashion, but it's avant-garde, and it's an actual piece that's meant to be a commentary on something else.
Oh, interesting.
So it's all, you know, I think about everything I do.
Interesting. I mean, we can tell that you think about every aspect of what you do, but I was wondering why there's so many face-obscuring outfits and hats, and, I mean, why is that?
It's part of my work. It's part of my work.
What's your average day like? When do you get up? When do you go to sleep? What are some of your rituals that you do every day?
I wake up and I get ready for my day. I have a book I like to read, I won't tell you what it is. I work all day long. I'm a control freak, but I try not to be. I try to trust, but I have a hand in everything I do. And I want it to be a very clear aesthetic that's almost propaganda, so that when you see the image, it's Gaga. Whether it's a video or it's a song or I'm live in front of you, it's Gaga.
Do you feel like a freak nowadays?
Well, no, I'm very comfortable in my work, and as a performance artist, I'm very deeply half satisfied and half dissatisfied all the time with what I'm putting out. That's the nature of being an artist. But in the beginning, it was like a boxing match, and I felt like Rocky because I was coming out of a commercial market that wants me to roll around in grease and touch myself and look like all the girls in the magazines, and I've never really conformed to that.
What about high school?
I felt like a freak in school and growing up, and I was uncomfortable because I was in a uniform and I didn't really fit in, and I was a really good student, but I was a bad kid, if that makes any sense. So like teachers wanted to be mad at me, but they couldn't because I aced all my tests. But when I went all my makeup on at the house, my mother would say, how are you going, kid? And I'd say, well, you know, what do you think of Marilyn today? Or I did Judy Garland today, Mom. And it was my way of expressing myself. There's no separation between the girl that my mother gave birth to and Gaga today. You resign to your work and you fully 100% become it.
So, I mean, it was always in you, but where did the Gaga-ness of you come from?
You know, that's the question I always say. You know, when they ask you, like, if you could ask your favorite artist of all time one thing, what would you ask them? And I always say I would ask John Lennon where he got his nerve. That's kind of what you're asking me. And I don't know. I don't know where my nerve came from. In the society that we live in, if a male artist were to come in here right now and say, I've got all these number ones and I'm taking over the world, you know, you probably wouldn't challenge him too much. But for women, it's a bit of a struggle. I've sold almost 5 million albums and I'm still fighting. Like, I'm on Just Dance. Ever since my career began, I've actually made an effort to stay out of the public eye as much as possible. There was a moment where I just couldn't escape, but now I've really tightened things up, so I'm sort of in hiding in a way to protect the music.
You are all in.
I'm all in. I'm sick of being with guys that tell me what I want to hear. Stop feeding me bullshit. Tell me the truth.
In November of 2009, Lady Gaga met with me for an On the Record. What you're watching are the lost tapes from that interview, the second part of a rare one-on-one with music's hottest young superstar. Here she gets into her commitment to gay rights. It's Lady Gaga, On the Record with Fuse, the lost tapes.
You say, I like it rough. Like what?
I think in that song, which was a B-side on the Fame, it was about masochistic behavior and love and addictive behavior, going back to people that aren't good for you. I like it rough.
Yeah, yeah.
But I've kind of moved on from that, and I'm in a more particular space. That's why the Fame Monster is with the Fame. I want everyone to see the yin and yang, and the transformation and the change and the progression of the artist. Each song represents a definite, true part of myself, and I wanted it to be halfway in between my previous work and a departure, something new and bigger. And dance music, I think, has been a bit convoluted in the US now.
What do you mean?
If you can dance to it, it's dance music. But I know what real dance music is. Right. So this record has got some real dance records on it. I want your drama, the touch of your hair.
Your dad had surgery. He's feeling better, you said. How's that going?
He's doing great.
Yeah.
I'm really happy.
You said he's your hero?
He is my hero.
And he's feeling good?
He's like a 17-year-old boy with a new heart.
And you wrote Speechless about him?
Yeah. I wrote it to convince him to have this surgery. And it took a little more than that to convince him, but the song definitely helped. And now I have my dad to hold my babies and walk me down the aisle. I mean, each song represents one in particular, but they kind of collide and meet. Teeth, for example, is my fear of the truth. I say, tell me something that'll save me. I need a man that makes me all right. You know, I'm sick of being with guys that tell me what I want to hear. Tell me, you know, stop feeding me bull. Tell me the truth.
You're a daddy's girl, right?
I'm a both. I'm mommy and daddy's. I'm Italian, so I worship my parents.
You've talked about to other people that, you know, if your dad did not approve, then you would have to change, right?
It's not that I would have to change. It's just that it genuinely affects me in a very deep way, and it would upset me. Whereas when, you know, some random person says something, it right. doesn't really mean anything. But my dad, for sure.
But you've won him over to loving Gaga-ness.
He loves my work. Because he sees the humor in the art now and in what I'm doing, you know. When I started to bleed to death on MTV, he was like laughing and crying, and he loved it. And, you know, he gets it. He gets what I'm saying. And, you know, that was a big moment for us, because for me, that was my first original artistic moment. That whole performance.
Mm-hmm. And your mom is more love you, whatever you do, you're the greatest.
Well, no, they tell me how it is.
So yeah. She's not always pleased.
No, I mean, well, but whose mother is, you know? It's not because I'm a pop artist, it's because I'm her daughter.
That was an incredible night. You got up on stage and got to get an award and, you know, shouting out to God and the gays. Why is it God and the gays? Shouldn't God be last?
You could do it either or. I think both is good. I guess God made the gays, so I guess God came first and then the gays came, so.
He absolutely did.
I love both equally, and you know, humanity, we are God.
People who are on the right side of gay rights have a tremendous amount of respect for you. She's not just a dance artist, she's not just a pop artist, she is actually walking the walk, has a real sort of political framework behind what she's talking about.
Yes. But again, I just want to reiterate as an artist that when I speak about these things, I want it to be clear that I'm not an activist in the sense of wanting to contribute to more anger and hate about an issue, because those things don't lead to success. We have to approach this with an energy of love and commitment and positivity. So just be strong in who you are and your feelings, but there's no reason to hate anyone for their views.
Yeah, and if you attack somebody for being homophobic, then people are like, oh, are you gay?
Right.
Which, then, like, not, you know, like, well, then where are you?
Well, that the point is that I feel, even just in the music industry, that there's very public misogynistic and homophobic behavior, whether it's in music or it's on the radio or it's live on TV. And the fact that the press never challenges them or crucifies any of these artists, because it's just kind of like, okay, because it's gay stuff. And if we were talking about race, it would be a very different story.
I mean, what is it that you want to see the Obama administration do, you know, going forward? Is it marriage equality? Is it repeal, don't ask, don't tell? What else?
Well, certainly repeal, don't ask, don't tell. You know, all of those things are extremely important. But in terms of full equality with marriage, I'd like to see it be more of a priority. as it affects a tremendous number of families in this country. And I would like to see Obama respond to the younger generation, who I am hoping to help be a part of, to rally, to have them come up and speak. But what I would like to see is for the Obama administration to acknowledge that no family and no person is any more valuable or important than another. I always, always loved Michael. And he was 23 when he put out Thriller, so he was in his prime.
In November of 2009, Lady Gaga sat with me for an On the Record. You're watching the lost tapes from that interview. To watch Gaga talk about some of her musical influences, and some of them surprised me. She also talks about Michael Jackson's death and its impact on her. This is the second part of a rare one-on-one with music's hottest young superstar. This is Lady Gaga On the Record with Fuse, the lost tapes.
One of the biggest moments of the year for everybody was when Michael Jackson passed away. What was your reaction when you heard he died? What were some of your thoughts?
I was with my whole team. We were in rehearsal and we got a phone call. The room just got so cold and dark, and all the dancers, and I was with Lorianne Gibson, and we just cried. We didn't believe it. We kept saying, no, that's not true.
Right.
We just didn't believe it. We just kept saying it can't be true, and then the tears started.
And he was an influence for you, too.
Oh, enormous influence. And I never didn't love him. Through all of the media drama and the nonsense, I never didn't love Michael. I always, always loved Michael.
How old were you when Thriller came out?
I wasn't born yet.
And yet, so when did you discover Thriller?
When I was 4 or 5. Years old. I mean, I listened to so much music in the house. My parents played everything for me. And he was 23 when he put out Thriller, so he was in his prime. So I'm 23 now, so I think it's my time to like hustle down and really kind of strive for greatness as an artist.
What kind of music did your parents play in the house?
Everything from Michael to Billy Joel to the Rolling Stones to Pink Floyd to Frank Sinatra to La Boheme. Everything. But not so feminine. They didn't play me a lot of really feminine music, I guess I should say. It was kind of like very specific energy that I remember of the music. It was a little bit raw, a little, love in a lovely way, you know, imperfect. And
I love that face.
Bruce Springsteen, that's the big with me and my dad. We're like the biggest Bruce fans ever.
Really? What was your defining onstage moment in 2009?
I don't think it was one moment. I think the VMAs was amazing, and I do think SNL was very powerful because it was one of the first times the world got to see me sit down and play the piano. See, it's funny that you ask me that, because in America, everybody's so fascinated with like the one and the number and the defining, and it's not about career anymore. It's about like singles and not about album, you know? It's what I mean to say is I'm not a song. I'm not a moment. I'm an artist. My defining moment was the whole year. You know, this was my first year that the world knew who I was and what I was trying to do. I'd say my defining moment, probably period, would be getting Just Dance played on the radio, because they didn't want to play it.
What was your biggest disappointment this year?
I didn't have any disappointment.
None? Everything's all up, no valleys?
Well, no, I mean, listen, everybody goes through, but you know, not something that I would like so emphatically say to you in an interview. I was very disappointed about this. You know, it's drama, it's melodrama that I don't want to give into. It's kind of like, I put all of the disappointment into the music, if that makes any sense. So like the fear and the monsters, the disappointment, that's in the record.
Yeah.
So if you want to know about that, you should listen to the music, because I don't allow that to enter into my own life.
Okay.
Or I try not to.
What are you really obsessed with now?
I'm obsessed with monsters and with death. To be perfectly ruthlessly but courteously honest.
Death. Like what?
The death of things that have passed. The death of my old life, but in a positive and wonderful way. You have to mourn things and then make way for the future. Because I have so many beautiful things that I love now. My fans are my whole world. I never would have been able to write what I wrote about on the road if they weren't giving to me every night in the show. Because I would do a show and I'd leave my heart on the floor, and they would give me so much, and then I would go onto the bus and would write. Some artists like to compartmentalize their work. Oh, when I'm on tour, I'm on tour. And when I'm recording, I'm recording. But I discovered that I'm not that way. And I've got a sea of inspiration in front of me every night.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're awesome.
Thank you.
Since sitting down with me last November, Gaga's album, The Fame, has been certified triple platinum and gone diamond globally. That's 10 million. She completed a sold-out leg of the Monster Ball World Tour. She released an awesome 9.5-minute video for Telephone and made internet history as the first artist with 1 billion total views for her music videos. I'm Torre. Thanks for watching.